Adam, how are you?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yeah, this is Andres Arena Gomez.
What are you going to do?
Hi, nice to meet you.
We are two.
That's for me.
That's el mundo.
We're going to be in charge of the interview.
Okay.
First of all, thanks very much for giving us the chance to talk to you.
No problem.
Let me just talk to the audience and explain then who you are and within just a few seconds, okay?
Okay.
En el contexto de la del evento, el Mapes Hemingway, es para nosotros un placer tener ahora a John Hemingway, hijo de Gregory Hemingway y nieto de Ernest Hemingway. John es traductor y escritor. Vive actualmente en Montreal y entre otras obras, quizás una de las que más ha dado que hablar hablando de Hemingway es justamente sus memorias familiares, Strange Pride. Justamente son memorias familiares que hablan sobre la infancia de John, pero también rastreando la de su propio padre, Gregory Hemingway. Y también rastreando algunas preguntas con respecto al abuelo sobre su narrativa, pero también y sobre todo sobre la intimidad de la familia. Thanks very much again. And we will start with Andres Arena Gomez. He has a few questions for you.
Well, first of all, I'm very happy to know that you're out in the theater because I am one too, so I'm sure we will understand each other with the meaning worldwide. Okay, I will start by asking you, is it a burden or a stimulus to be called Hemingway? Estoy preguntado que si él considera que es una carga difícil de llevar o es un estímulo llamarse Hemingway.
Well, I think I would have to answer that thinking about the different periods of my life. When I was younger, I really had no conception of how important my grandfather was, and so the only thing that mattered to me was my father. So yes, I was John Hemingway, but all that meant is that I was Gregory Hemingway's son, and that was fine with me. Later on, I decided that I wanted to write. It was difficult because I knew, I hadn't yet discovered my own voice as a writer, and so I was terribly worried about whether I would write well or not. It was only when I discovered that you cannot write anything but who you are, that it became easier. And I'm very proud of my grandfather and the fact that I am, his grandson, because I love his writing and I'm still amazed every time I read it.
Bueno, nos dijo John que evidentemente esa consideración de hasta qué punto ha sido un peso o un estímulo, como digo, se acercaba. Cuando era más joven, cuando era jovencito, tal vez no a eso se preocupaba especialmente de su padre y tal vez el abuelo era una referencia un poco distinta. Luego hay un momento en el que él empieza a escribir y él está buscando su propia voz y en ese momento es cuando ya la consideración hacia su abuelo naturalmente cambia y desde luego se declara orgulloso de portar ese apellido y de ser un miembro de la.
What you are. This is my mix of English, Spanish, and
Louisiana.
Shall we turn?
Okay.
father Gregory, like to explain that in your book, to cross-dressing, and to change sex just before his death in the year 2001, if I'm not wrong. On the contrary, your grandfather...
Actually, he had the operation about 6 years before he died, basically.
I see.
Yes.
On the contrary, your grandfather Ernest was sort of the icon of American macho. However, in your memoir, Strange Tribe, you suggest that Gregory and Ernest have very much in common in terms of their sexual orientation and gender roles. This is quite surprising for a person that just heard about, you know, the official tales, statements about Ernest Hemingway. Could you explain this, please? Ah, sì. Il padre di John Gregory è una persona che diciamo, praticava il tarotismo desde niño e incluso tuvo una intervención para cambiar de sexo antes de su muerte, algunos años antes de su muerte. Por lo contrario, el abuelo de John, Ernest Hemingway, está considerado como digamos, el estereotipo de macho americano. Sin embargo, sus memorias, las memorias de John Strange Tribe, sugiere que Gregory y Ernest tenían bastante en común en términos de orientación sexual y roles de género. Y le estoy pidiendo a John que nos explique un desarrollo un poco esta aparente contradicción.
Yes, it is, on the surface, it looks like a tremendous contradiction that I could even suggest something like this. Because, as you mentioned there, it was a macho icon of the 20th century. Usually when I talk about my book, I point out the similarities between my father and my grandfather, and these are similarities which include not just the fascination with, as Mao would put it, the other half of the sky, but also the fact that my father was very much like his father, in that he was an excellent hunter. He won a ski shooting contest in Cuba when he was 12 years old, against adults, a national contest. He was the one who my grandfather thought would be the one who would continue after him as a writer. I mean, he really saw himself in his youngest son. If you want to translate this, maybe right now, but I'll continue with this.
Sí, bueno, sobre la pregunta de la contradicción que existe entre tu abuelo, que es, como ha dicho antes, mi icono, macho, y la situación de su padre, que es una relación, etcétera, dice John que mantiene que hay semejanzas entre los dos, más de la que parece aparentemente.
They were, at the same time, both very macho. I'm not saying that Ernest was not that, he was that, he was macho, and so was my father, up to a certain point. At the same time, I discovered that there was a connection between these two men. It wasn't just my father who was the black sheep of the family, some sort of monster or something. There was a connection. There was a very deep connection here. And I found it, surprisingly enough, in my grandfather's writing. I found it in his short stories, as far back as the 1920s, and I'm talking about A Simple Inquiry, I'm talking about Sea Change, I'm talking about The Big Two-Hearted River. And we have an examination in my grandfather's work, on my grandfather's part, of just what it is to be a man, where a man begins, where a woman ends, where the two connect.
Estoy cierto que los dos tenían una imagen de macho y Gregory no era solamente la oveja negra de la familia. Había una conexión evidente entre Gregory y Ernest. De hecho, Gregory también tenía un entrenamiento, una práctica de escritura, y yo he encontrado algunos cuentos escritos por Gregory. La parte
final... No, por mi abuelo.
Ah, perdón, disculpa.
Por mi abuelo. De cuentos tipo... ¿cómo se llama? Una pregunta sencilla que se trata de la Primera Guerra Mundial en un cuento que da una... ¿qué se llama? Muy fácil, it's a short story. It's a short story which talks about a gay maiden, so la muchacha, la muchacha italiano che è parte è gay, e lui fa una domanda a un soldato semplice, perché lui il maggiore è uno che deve leggere la lettera dello soldato semplice. E pregunta al soldato, ma è verità che tu chiedi alla tua ragazza, alla tua mujer, un soldato è un nervoso, perché questo è un diciamo, perché e c'è questo dialogo, questa dialettica tra lo so, perché e no, io mi chiedevo perché un tipo come mio abuelo ha deciso di scrivere un cuento a te, perché no one was talking again, but that's true in the end, I don't know. Uno che si chiama in inglese a sea change, un cambiamento del mar, okay? Si parla di una pareja, una joven pareja che è la mujer che quiere irse perché quiere avere una relazione da homosexual con nosotros, la mujer, que es muy confuso, ¿verdad? Pero es un fin que la mujer tenida, el hombre, yo he visto el original del cuento, la visita que hay en inglés, es una parte que Ernesto ha cambiado de vida, pero al fin el hombre guarda a otra pareja homosexual de Dios, los hombres. Y si quieres te pregunto pues que todos los hombres son así. Gracias.
Bueno, la referencia se cambia muy bien. The name of the story, the second one is the Sea Change. I know that one. What was the name of the first story?
The first one was called A Simple Inquiry.
Ah, simple Inquiry. Bueno, que son dos relatos que John ha estudiado con la atención y el otro se llama Sea Change, el mar cambia, ¿no?
Un artista in senso puro, cioè che teneva, come dice in italiano, spingere il confine, perché cioè, teneva a scrivere algo di nuovo, perché non era bastante scrivere le cose normali, cioè, the usual things, he had to push, perché he was pushing it, okay? And I found the short story fascinating. It's another side of that. Mucho más complejo como hombre, como escritor, mucho más moderno para mí.
Bueno, existe un poco en la relación verdaderamente admite que en los relatos, cortos es donde da su abuelo la mejor medida, y que desde luego tiene unos enfoques que siempre son nuevos y parece que pueden ser siempre
Seguramente
San Juan
Juan
está ambientado en la Primera Guerra Mundial, ¿no? Uh-huh.
Su frente
austríaca italiana. Su frente austríaca italiana. Bueno, I'd like to change a little bit the subject now. I'm going to another book that belongs to the same as that, Strange Pride. I'm talking about Running with the Bulls.
Okay.
Well, my question is, do you believe Running with the Bulls is a sincere book?
Well, I think that my stepmother Valerie was probably sincere when she wrote it. It is another story. It is another vision of my grandfather, especially of my father. I disagree with her vision of my father. And for me, it's surprising because she lived with my father for a long, long, long time. And she knew also my grandfather. And I was amazed that she could not see the connection between the two. It's almost as if, you know, Ernest was the great writer, okay, no one can touch him. And my father was, well, was something unfortunate almost. Okay, she loved the man, I know that, okay? But I have a very different opinion of my father and my grandfather, she does. I respect her opinion, but it is not mine.
Okay,
¿qué? Hemos preguntado sobre el libro de Valerie, Correr con los toros. By the way, the guy who translated the book in Spanish has just gone.
Oh.
Miguel Martínez Laje.
I'm sorry to hear
that. Well, en cualquier caso, le preguntaba sobre qué le parece si el correr con los toros de Valerie Hemingway lo podríamos establecer como, digamos, que una joven que hace un papel parecido, ¿no? Pues, si trae de acuerdo a Diana Imanchi en su momento.
Oh my God. She was very young, extremely young, when she met my grandfather. And probably Ernest could have, he would have gone with her, okay? But at the time, I don't think he was capable really of doing much of anything.
Hold on, when you just translate what you just said, dice que con respecto al libro de Valerie, que es, lo considera sincero, porque le ha preguntado Andrés si considera que el libro, que es una suerte de memoria de Valerie, de esposa de Gregory, es un libro sincero. John responde que sí lo considera un libro sincero, pero tiene otra visión ese libro de Ernest Hemingway, y sobre todo otra visión de su padre, del padre de John, Gregory. Le sorprende un poco a John que, habiendo vivido tanto tiempo con Gregory como marido y mujer, no haya descubierto la conexión que existe entre Gregory y Ernest, la conexión de la que ya hablábamos en la pregunta anterior. Y obviamente John tiene una diferente visión de su padre, de Gregory, que expresa muy bien en sus memorias de The Strange Tribe, más o menos.
For example, I want to go a little farther than that. When Valerie says about discovering, for example, what was going on and changing what was going on, apparently she finds out that suddenly something that comes out from strange idea. Obviously, if you meet with someone, you notice this kind of thing. Do you understand what I mean?
I find that rather implausible. Because, I mean, I remember when I first found out that my father cross-dressed, and I was at university at the time at UCLA, and I visited him for a weekend, okay? And my brother, Valerie's son, Brendan, said, hey, you know, Dad, he dresses up and puts a wig on and stuff like that. So when I went back to Los Angeles, I told my mother this. She said, oh, Dad, he's doing that when I married him, like that. Mi padre es director de UE, hace décadas, as far back as the 1950s. Remember that he was arrested, okay, for going into a woman's bathroom at a movie theater in Los Angeles in 1951, okay? En 1951, ¿ok? Con su prima mujer, ¿ok? Con su prima, mi madre, ¿ok? Mi madre es la segunda, no la segunda, la segunda mujer. O sea, es mi padre.
Oh, okay.
¿Qué pasa?
Andrés.
Bueno, se refiere a la detención, se ha referido a la detención de 1961. Parece que es un punto así importante. Realmente.
Sí. Que me sorprende que, bueno, Andrés preguntó si. No piensa que Daniel era un poco, no sé, inocente o naivo, de no darse cuenta, bueno, de la orientación íntima que tenía Gregory. Y John, sí, dice que efectivamente era como un secreto público en la familia, de que Gregory tenía prácticas de cross-dressing, ¿no? De vestirse con trajes femeninos. Y de hecho, él comenzó a darse cuenta cuando ya era estudiante en UCLA, la Universidad de Los Ángeles, por primera vez. Y de hecho, era público además, no solamente era un secreto a voces en la familia. En 1950, su padre, Gregory, fue arrestado por entrar al baño de mujeres con su primo. El 51, perdón. Actually, was 1951 or 1950?
1951, because that was also the year that his mother died. I mean, his abuela left in 51.
Okay.
Yeah, 51.
Okay. When we talked last Saturday for the first time, and thinking about not only this, you know, intimate aspect, but also basically about the richness of Ernest Hemingway's books and narratives, you try to underline ambiguity. There was just 50 years ago considered a mental or religious problem. And nowadays this word tends to be considered a value. Again, not only in terms of, you know, interactions, human interaction, but also in terms of narrative. The question is, why do you think editors, you mentioned that the Garden of Eden was censored, and there's a few paragraphs that were, you know, taken out from the original production. Why is this way? Why it's sort of hidden forces that try to reinforce this idea of Hemingway the way obviously the family don't see him. Why is it that editors?
Sorry, la ambigüedad puede ser considerada un problema mental o religioso simplemente hace 50 años. Hoy en día el mundo parece considerar un valor cuando se piensa en las interacciones modernas, incluso
negativa.
En ese sentido, Ernest resulta ser mucho más contemporáneo de lo que pensábamos. ¿Por qué nosotros teníamos la acceso a ese estereotipo macho de Ernesto.
Y también agregaba que ya entrando en la narrativa, el libro, el Garden of Eden, fue censurado, hay párrafos que fueron retirados. Y le pregunto a John, ¿por qué cree que esto es así? ¿Que nos aferramos? ¿O que las fuerzas oscuras del mercado o los editores? ¿Quién está tratando de reforzar esta imagen estereotipada de grandes hombres? Go ahead, John.
Es difícil decirlo, because I think on one hand, many people have a very thick image of who Ernest Hemingway was. La gente aún se imagina muy claro, así me acuerdo, que como el supermacho este mismo siglo. But on the other hand, the editors are afraid of doing something which would go against this image. It's a very powerful image. I know this for a fact, that I had to come up against this image. And, it is not easy to show people that he was different, okay? On the other hand, I mean, just, you know, el hijo de la nariz de los años dientes, okay? I mean, Paris in the 1920s was connected, in a certain sense, with Berlin. It was the center of art, but also of transgression, okay, sexual transgression, being different, it was okay. He was someone who grew artistically in that atmosphere. So it's only normal that if he had certain, how would you say, ideas, if he was fascinated by androgyny, okay, that this would come out in terms. That terms allowed him to be the person he was.
Before going into the Garden of Eden piece of the question, let me just translate this. Que hay una imagen rígida de Ernest Hemingway y que los editores tendían a, digamos, a no mostrar esa imagen que fuera en contra de esta imagen, ¿no? O de presentar una imagen que fuera diferente de esta imagen estereotipada. De hecho, Ernest Hemingway decide ir a París en los años 20, y París era un centro de arte y también de transgresión sexual. Y Hemingway produce en este, en esta muestra particular. ¿Algo más? Okay. So go ahead with Garden of Eden. Could you confirm that there were pieces of Garden of Eden that were?
Absolutely. There was one piece which I found in the original version, which talks about it's a dialogue between the protagonist of the book, David, I think, and his girlfriend, Catherine, right? Yeah. And they are imagining themselves in a kind of androgynous union. And he says, it's like that statue by Rodin, okay? The statue is the metamorphosis, okay? Where you can't tell where the man begins and the woman ends, okay? Now, I used that part of his book in my original manuscript, but the family made me take it out, okay? And I had to paraphrase that, okay? This is just one example of how it was changed, but I mean, there are many other examples. This is my personal experience of kind of censorship. If you can get a hold of an advanced reader copy of my book, you'll find the original passage. But the copy that you have, Irma, has that part which has been paraphrased by me because I was not allowed to use it.
Que fue uno de los libros póstumos que salió, y John señala que hay varios párrafos suprimidos,
que se de moda. y que también John quería poner una distancia con respecto a su familia. Su padre, Gregory, era bipolar, su madre era esquizofrénica. Ahora, los italianos fueron siempre muy simpáticos y nunca lo molestaron con esta historia de este enfrentamiento.
Vale, pues, hace 45 años que Dios translate, que Dios translate en lugar, que Dios translate from Italia, todo el mundo de inglés.
And you have an enormous the courage to go through these dangers, I mean, to ride these dangers. Thank you again, and Andres.
Let me say goodbye to you. First of all, you've been very, very brave, you know, I admire you for, you know, being able to face the things that you do. Thank you very much. And obviously, I wish you the best for this strange trial. And obviously, I am going to read your translations. I'm sure they will be wonderful. I'm very interested in this, Benedetti's one. Okay, thank you very much.
And I just want to invite you to the recording and matter,
I want to come on again this year, I guess.
I see.
They've invited me to be the, what they call the Guiri of the Year, which is bad for
a Guiri.
The Guiri, la nombrado por la
Guiri.
Okay, so
I'm going to do it again, you know, for the usual round of craziness.
Okay, and I hope this is not going to be the last time we meet virtually, and I'm going to read Gloria with very much interest and get in touch with you.
Okay, we wish you the best. La familia, de padres, etcétera, sino exponerlo con esa naturalidad, ¿no? Y que no es cierto, porque a lo mejor este tipo de cosas que siempre te preguntan, que siempre te preguntan por tu abuelo, que siempre te preguntan por tu padre, que es una cosa un poco escabrosa, parece que se presta un poco al morbo, etcétera, no ha tomado con una naturalidad que para mí quisiera, ¿no?
En Pamplona forma parte de un grupo que se llama el Club de los Gatos. Porque se empezó a apasionar con el tema de Pamplona y todos los años el Club de los Gatos lo repite, por supuesto, el bar. Entonces es un poco la fiesta.
A lo mejor es ahí donde lo han nombrado el
guiri del año.
Claro, de ahí viene el tema ese.
Decir que las memorias, efectivamente, como dice Andrés, yo me he permitido, lo comentaba Andrés, podemos preguntarle estas cosas, que es un poco controversial, ¿no? Su padre, tal y tal. Y le dije, no, porque lo medular de esas memorias es eso. Le toma el tono por las asas y lo arroja al público, y por eso le dije a John, entiendo que escribir estas memorias en algún momento pudo haber sido doloroso. Y creo que eso se manifiesta en esas páginas, ¿no? Y lo dice John, y ya fue en Italia porque quería poner un mal entre él y su familia en un momento, ¿no? Bueno, tomamos un descanso. Tomamos unos 10 minutos y empezamos con la...